Hey there, brothers and sisters. Pastor Chris Holman here of Nine Line Ministries. I'm here with a message that the Lord laid on my heart. And I could do this, I could have done this as a sermon, but I wanted to share this with you. It may come off as a sermon, and maybe it is, but this is a message that the Lord laid on my heart, and I opened my Bible directly to what I needed. The Lord is good. The Holy Spirit guides us and keeps us and shows us the way. Amen. So I want you to open your Bibles. If you have your Bible with you, you know, you should, if you regularly watch my content, you should probably get in the habit of just having your Bible with you. Amen. Always in the Word of God. And I apologize. I have this with my throat that happens ever so often, but I'm having a little problem with my throat. So just bear with me. So open your Bibles to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. I want to begin with prayer. You know, we should get in the habit of praying, even if it's just a small prayer, as often as we can to seek God in prayer. If only just to praise Him, to worship Him, to come to Him with our troubles and our cares, to pray for others that we know that are in need, to go to Him in prayer. So we will begin today with prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you today in praise and thanksgiving for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you have yet to do in our lives. Lord God, we praise you for your goodness and your mercy, and we pray that your will be done today and every day, that you use us as your instrument to witness to the world. Lord God, I pray that you use this message to speak to the hearts of all those that see it. That believers will have a new zeal for you, and that new souls will be won for you, to you, that will come to know you, to walk with you, that will come to you in repentance. Lord God, I praise you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, your saving power through your Son, Jesus Christ, his shed blood on the cross. Lord God, I praise you for you are holy. I praise you for you are God. In Jesus' holy name, in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. All right. So let's begin with this message that God has laid on my heart that I wish to share with you. We see here in verse 19 and 20 is the Great Commission given to us by Christ. It says in the beginning here in verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, sharing the gospel with all, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, to baptize. I preached about baptism. We'll get to this. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. We're going to break this down. You see, there's so much in the Word of God that Christians, especially older Christians, I don't mean in age, but have been Christians for years, oftentimes we tend to just overlook many verses in the Bible. We've heard it so many times, whether we understand it or not, it just becomes, well, I'll just say it's taken for granted oftentimes. And nobody really, well, I'm not going to say nobody, but many, they just take for granted what it says. They don't look any deeper into it. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. I ask you watching this, believers, do you share the gospel, the good news of Christ with others? Do you teach other believers, discipling them or being there for them when they go through trials, tribulations, struggles, hardships of life? Are you there for one another? Are you advancing the kingdom of God on earth? Have you taken the light of Christ unto yourself, the saving power in the shed blood of Christ, taking that light and just selfishly hiding it? Or are you sharing it with the world? Let it be a beacon, a great lighthouse in the midst of the darkness of this world. Are you doing the work of God to win souls to Him? It's a commission, is what we are all charged to do. Not just some, not just your pastor, not just your worship leader or the worship team, not just your small group leaders, if your church has that, Bible study leaders. Each and every one of us are charged with this by God, by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to teach all the nations. You know, when Paul had his experience, his conversion on the road to Damascus, Jesus said to him, "It is difficult to kick against the pricks." I've explained to this before, but I'm going to explain it here because it is very important. This verse, it's another verse often misunderstood. Many just don't take the time to understand what that means. Another word for this is also goad. It's where we get the phrase goading someone. In the first century, shepherds would carry a sharpened stick, oftentimes with a piece of metal at the end. And if there was a wayward lamb trying either refusing to go or starting to go off in another way, they would poke that lamb with the goad or the prick. Now, if that lamb were to suddenly kick backwards against it, they risked skewering their leg on that goad or that prick. It's difficult to kick against the pricks. When we are confronted with the truth of our sin and our wickedness and our wretchedness before a holy and righteous God, when we are presented with the truth in His Word, the truth of His saving grace through the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross, when we are confronted with the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is difficult to kick against the prick. You can answer the call, or you can turn away. You can reject it. You have that free will. You have it. Know that the wages of our sin is death, and that wage, like our paycheck, is earned and deserved. But the gift of salvation is freely offered and given to all who would receive it. We need only come before the cross of Christ, before God humbly like a child. To confess, to repent of our sins. What does that mean to repent? It means to confess your sin with sincerity and to turn, make a 180 and turn from your sin towards God. You see, it is our sin. I'm giving full measures of truth and grace here. Truth and grace. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Our sin separates us from God. And God is a just God and will not abide sin. He hates sin. Yes, God hates. He hates sin. He hates unrighteousness. He hates iniquity. He hates sin and will not abide it. We are all wretched sinners to our core. And there is nothing that you and I can do to save ourselves from our sin. It is only through faith in Jesus Christ and the saving grace of God that we can be forgiven of our sins. Full measures, truth and grace, grace and truth. I promise you, those watching this, I promise you, I will never sugarcoat the word of God. I will condemn what God condemns in his word. I will condemn sin as God condemns sin, as God is calling you to repentance. I will share that with you. In hope, and I pray that the Holy Spirit lay a conviction upon your heart. But know this, the grace of God, the love of God, the mercy of God is immeasurable. There is no amount of sin, nothing that you can do to exclude you from His love and mercy and grace. God right now, simultaneously, with one hand is holding back His wrath that each and every one of us so rightfully deserve. We deserve. And with His other hand, He is reaching out to each and every one of us and He is saying, come unto me, all ye who are heavy laden. I will give you rest. I love you, my child. Come unto me. Accept my free gift of salvation and I will forgive you of your sins. Wash it away. It will not just be forgotten, but forgotten. You will be clothed in His righteousness to be found holy and righteous on that day of judgment. It is a free gift. We are saved by faith, not by works, lest anyone boast, said Paul. We are justified by grace. To those watching this that have not accepted Christ, I say to you that God is here today, right now, with His hand extended, calling you to Him. God, the creator of the universe, who set everything in motion, who exists. This is who God is. I need you to know this. God is all-knowing, He is all-powerful, and He is ever-present everywhere. He exists outside of time and looks at the timeline of eternity from beginning to end and everything in between simultaneously. God is love, God is mercy, God is grace. He's a God of healing, of deliverance, of renewal. God of salvation, God of forgiveness. He's a jealous God. You will not have other gods before Him. He's a God of justice, of judgment, and of wrath. He's a just God. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. But just as He is a just God, those who have rejected His free gift will be justly judged and condemned on that day of judgment. is calling you to Him. He's here today. To those of you watching this who are believers, who are saved, born again, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Spirit, I ask you, are you sharing the gospel? It might be something as simple as when you're out in public and someone says, hey, how are you doing? And you say, I'm good. I'm good because God is good. Let me tell you about Jesus. Oh, I'm good because I'm forgiven. Praise God. Are you proclaiming Christ? Are you furthering the kingdom of heaven? Listen, we have been given this free gift. All people, it's offered to all people. It's offered to all. We can accept it or we can reject it. That is your choice. But know this, if you reject the salvation through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, if you reject this free gift, you will be judged. Full measures truth here. You will be judged justly for your sin on that day of judgment. There will be hellfire. There will be damnation. You will be separated from the presence of God forevermore. Now, I'm going to give you an analogy here so that you can fully understand the presence of God. We breathe air. And unless we are exhausted or have or labored breathing because we've been working out or whatever it is, we just breathe. We take it for granted. We don't even notice that we're breathing. We don't even pay attention to the air around us. We just take it for granted that it's there. We don't even notice it. So too is the presence of God. Now, in this very room I am in right now, if suddenly all of the air was sucked out and I found myself in a vacuum, I would be immediately aware of my desire and need to breathe. How much I need that air right now. And I would suffocate and die if that air was not returned. So too is it with the Spirit of God. On that day of judgment, those who are condemned will find themselves separated from God. They will no longer have that presence of God. How terrifying would it be to suddenly find yourself in a room with no oxygen, with no air? How terrifying would it be to suddenly realize your entire existence, you have been in the presence of God and didn't know it. And now that it's gone, just as your body would die without air, now you spiritually die. You are no longer sustained by the great Creator. The wages of sin is death. The penalty of our sin, which we all deserve, is that eternal death and damnation. You don't have to be. Because you see, the penalties for your sin have already been paid by Jesus Christ on the cross 2,000 years ago. Jesus Christ bore the sins of the world, becoming sin for us, paying our debt. And we need only accept Him, to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that He is the only begotten Son who died on the cross and in 3 days rose from the dead and ascended unto heaven, who sits at the right hand of God, and His promise to us is His return. And on His return, the dead in Christ shall rise. The dead and the living will meet Him in the sky in glory, and He will judge the living and the dead. Our God is good. Listen, this our God, the creator of all things, this God, our God, he fully knows and loves you. He has fully known and loved you since before your birth. And he's calling you to him. Now listen, listen here. I'm preaching and I want you to listen to me. This gospel, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is not a mystery to learn and lock away. It is to share with all that will hear it. All creatures, all people. Believers, are you doing it? Are you doing it? Are you sharing the gospel? Are you walking in a lifestyle of love, the love of Christ? Are you sharing the love of Christ with all that you meet? Have you been baptized? And have you led others to Christ to be baptized, to walk with God, to read the Word of God? Listen, I love reading the Word of God. I have a hunger and a desire for the Word of God. Now listen, I don't love the Word of God because I preach. I preach because I love the Word of God. I preach because God has called me here to do so. Teaching them to observe, going to verse 20 here, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. What has Jesus commanded us? He told us to love God with all that we are. Heart, body, and mind, all of it, to love God. What does that actually mean? It means to put God first in our life, to love him with our every being. The first of our love is to God. I tell you, whatever is first in your life is your God. If you're a believer and God is at first, whatever is first is your God. And he tells us to love our neighbors as ourself. What does that mean? Well, how do you love yourself? You love yourself enough to feed yourself. Go feed the hungry. You love yourself enough to clothe yourself. Go clothe those in need. You love yourself enough to want someone to listen to your struggles and your pain, to be there for you, to be empathetic and compassionate to you. Do that for others. Be there for them. Jesus tells us to love our enemies, to pray for those who use and abuse us. It's easy to love your friends. It's easy to love your family. It's hard to love your enemy. To those who hate you, who curse you, who persecute you. We're to love as God loves. And God loves each and every one of us. We condemn sin as God condemns sin, but we love as God loves. We walk in love and let that love be a lifestyle. Because you see, character is what you do when you think others aren't looking. And the only way that you can do that is if that is a lifestyle. So if we're to love as God loves, to love all people, that love must be a lifestyle for us to always do it, even when we think no one is looking. Jesus tells us not to hate in our heart. If you hate your brother unjustly, you have committed murder already. Jesus tells us not to lust after another woman in our heart, because if we have, we've committed adultery already. Jesus warns of hypocrisy. And Jesus tells us that we will judge them by their fruit. You see, our fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, It's not the means of our salvation. There's no works that can save you. It is evidence of it. To observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And he says then, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Listen to me very carefully. When you are in the deepest, darkest valley, you may be in it right now. You're not alone. You weren't alone then. You're not alone now. You are never, ever alone. God is always with you. Now listen. Listen to me. Whatever you're going through, you can endure it all. You can endure all things because he who endured it all on the cross resides in you. And you are never, ever alone. When you walk with God, God walks with you. You know, there's this poem. It's this famous poem, Footsteps in the Sand. And it's kind of corny and kind of cliche, but it's truth. It goes on where, you know, a man, he's talking to Jesus. And he's looking back at his life and he sees the footprints of his life in the sand. And there's two footprints. And there are places where there's only one set of footprints and then others. And he says, Jesus, you said you would always be with me, but I look back and I only see one set of footprints. Why did you abandon me? And Jesus said, I didn't abandon you. It was in those moments that I carried you. You are never alone when you walk with God. He is with us always, even unto the end of the world. Now listen, you can be totally and fully unloved. No one loves you. Everyone hates you. Yet you have the greatest love of all, the love of God, an unconditional, unimaginable, immeasurable love that we cannot fully fathom, the love of God. He fully knows and loves you and is always with you. Amen? Listen, because in the eyes of God, you are precious. You have intrinsic worth and God loves you. You matter to him. You're precious in his sight. He wants you to be with him. From everlasting to everlasting, he wants you to be with him. He wants to be reconciled to you just as a father, an earthly father, wants their wayward children to come home. Our heavenly Father is calling you to him. He says you've sinned. You've sinned so greatly. And you think that it's just too much. That I couldn't possibly love you. But he says, listen, I love you this much. He's here today to forgive you of all of your sins. There is no sin so great that it would separate you from his love and mercy and grace. He loves you. God loves you. If you're thinking right now, well, I can wait till tomorrow, or I can wait until after the holidays. Well, I'll wait until after I have the fun of my youth, and when life begins to slow down, then I'll come to God. Then I'll get right with him. Then I'll make that change. Listen to me. Our life, our time on this earth is finite, and nobody knows how finite it is. Tomorrow is never promised. You can die in your sleep tonight. You could be in a horrible car accident. God forbid, but you could be in a horrible car accident going to work. and never make it home. Do not put off what you could do right now in this moment. If the Holy Spirit is laying a conviction upon your heart, do not tarry. Do not wait. Do not let this moment pass you by, not the blink of an eye. If God has laid a conviction upon your heart, if you see today, right now, the wretch that you are, the sinful nature that we all have, that is who we are without Christ, that we are sinners, each and every last one of us, undeserving of the grace and mercy of God. If you realize that right now, this has come, the scales have been lifted from your eyes, and you see that this God, our God, has given to you, offer to you now this free gift of salvation. If he's calling you to him, do not let this moment pass you by, not one. Humbly come before God. Kneel down wherever you are. If you're in your car, pull over and pray with me.
Father, I know that I have broken your laws and my sins have separated me from you. I am truly sorry, and now I want to turn away from my past sinful life toward you. Please forgive me and help me avoid sinning again. I believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, died for my sins, was resurrected from the dead, is alive, and hears my prayer. I invite Jesus to become the Lord of my life, to rule and reign in my heart from this day forward. Please send your Holy Spirit to help me obey you and to do your will for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you for coming. Our God is so very good, and he loves you so immeasurably so. Those who have prayed that prayer with me, God bless you. You are saved. Find you a church. Get a Bible and read it. Read it. Learn it. Love it. Live it. Have it imprinted upon your heart. This Bible is both God's roadmap and guide for our lives, leading us to eternal life with him. But it is also God's love letter to us. And in it, we find his divine plan set in motion so long ago, culminating in the death and resurrection of his Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our God is so very good. Amen. Our God is good. He is good all the time. He is good. He is good. He is good. I ask you to keep me in your prayers. If any of you have any prayer requests, put them in the comment section below. I will most assuredly pray for you. You can always leave prayer requests in the comment section. Our God is a God of love. God bless.
Need to go back. Back, back, back. Oh, we need to go back, 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 back.